You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning and welcome to Health in Public Education, Health Science 300 here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I'm Robin Sinks, I'm your instructor for the course, and we are in the seventh session of our 14-week semester. So this is our midpoint, and I'm glad you are with us. Last week we started to look at the third of the six content areas in health education. We started to break into that content area of nutrition and physical education. Physical activity. We took a look at the cost of unhealthy eating, factors that influence healthy eating. We did a quick review of some of the macro and micronutrients, and then introduced the dietary guidelines for Americans. I hope you had some time to take a look at some of the websites that I showed you at the end of our broadcast last week, particularly around the website choosemyplate.gov. That's kind of the starting place for all things nutrition and physical activity. And I hope that through this last week, you were able to think about what you were eating, what your students were eating. I hope thought about some ways that you could enhance your eating patterns so they were just a little bit more healthy. We're not asking folks to change everything they eat, but just making those shifts into healthier food choices. And as we do that bit by bit, we can certainly start to adapt more of those behaviors. So I certainly want to continue our discussion. And today we're going to look specifically at reading food labels and how that helps us access valid information. I also want to talk a little bit about healthy weight management. As we've talked several times about the obesity epidemic and particularly the impact on kids, I think one of our gut level reactions is, well, we've got to get kids to lose the weight. So how do we do that in a way that is healthy, that doesn't demean our students or their families? And we do that in a way that it's a lifelong eating adventure rather than going on a diet. And then I want to finish up our 2 hours this morning looking at physical activity, what we should be striving toward and how we might actually incorporate some of that into our daily routines. So we'll start out our first hour still looking at the nutrition side of the coin, and then we'll move into that physical activity later on. So to kind of get you to thinking about your own practices, my question of the day is, how do you help students choose healthier foods? What do you, as an adult working in a school setting, do to help your students choose those healthier foods? How do you influence their choices? I would really like to hear from you and get some of your ideas and what you're doing in your classrooms. And so you can respond to that question of the day either by calling, there's our 800 number, or you can email me. And coming up next will be our email address. Either way, whichever you're comfortable with, I'd like to hear from you. And certainly that is a way that you can earn a little bit of extra credit in the class as well, is to participate in the conversation here this morning. So anyway, how do you help students choose healthier foods? As you think about your response to that, what I'd like to do is just a quick review of where we stopped off last week and address the dietary guidelines for Americans. Now, the dietary guidelines for Americans is really visualized in that graphic right behind me, choose my plate. And it's really talking about my plate. And here is an instructional tool that, you know, is certainly available for purchase, but something that teachers can easily have students make in the classroom to really help kids understand how we look at foods and what might encompass that healthy eating pattern. Remember, you don't always have to have your dairy on the side as in a glass of milk. You can always have dairy on the plate itself. Please note that these are not four equal parts. We really want to look at half the plate being fruits and vegetables, more vegetables than fruit, and then looking at splitting up the other half of the plate by grains and proteins. So we'll remind you in just a few minutes about some of the messages about each one of these, but it's a visual cue, and that's all it is. It's not a prescription for filling each part of your plate, because we know oftentimes we eat foods that have many groups in the same food. So you can mix these up, just kind of look at the proportion. All right, so those healthy, those dietary guidelines for healthy Americans. When I referred you to choosemyplate.gov last week, there's so much information, but I would like to go back to that website. So if we could go to my screen here on the desk. This is choosemyplate.gov, and when the dietary guidelines first came out, this was on one of those front page banners. It's now been around long enough that they've put it into the website. So what you'll have to do is just write out up here in the search, dietary guidelines for Americans, you will end up on this page. Here you can find, you can read the entire document if you so choose. You can find out your answers to the questions you might have about caffeine, cholesterol, fat, etc. An easy reference to those My Plate messages. And I referred to a couple of them. Make half your plate fruits and vegetables. So we want to focus on whole fruit and vary the veggies. We want to make half your grains whole grains. We want to move to low-fat and fat-free milks and yogurts. Vary your protein routine. You know, choose a variety of proteins, animal and plant. And then drink and eat less sodium, saturated fat, and added sugars. Here are also some resources. Let me see if that's pretty big. There we go. That might help. When you go onto this site, also look at the resources and tools for professionals. My Plate, My Wins. Those are tip sheets that you can use with some of your older students, with parents, with staff. Super Tracker is an online resource where you can literally track what you are eating and your activity and help you set some goals for improvement. There is the daily checklist and then a lot more resources down here. So I do want you to explore all of this, knowing that even here on the side, you've got additional resources. This website is information rich. Lots of resources to go to here. And again, when we talk about, you know, the dietary guidelines, the big messaging, I found this chart that really summarizes those five that I addressed last time. So we can come back to me, you can leave the site. And remember those five kind of as that big picture tool. First, about healthy eating across the lifespan. We want to choose healthy eating patterns that are appropriate for each age group. Young children need more of certain nutrients than older adults. We need to make sure that we are getting the recommended nutrients as we age. So one size does not fit all. We also want to look at variety, nutrient density, and amount. So when you are thinking about your eating patterns, you know, look at a variety of foods. Choose those foods that are nutrient dense. You know, let go of some of maybe more of the processed foods that have that nutrient light air to them. And watch the amount of foods that you eat. Yes, some of these food groups are very healthy, but if we eat in excess, we're still consuming too many calories. The third big message out of the dietary guidelines was to limit added sugars, saturated fats, and sodiums. So again, reading labels becomes an important skill as we do all of this. Look for those extra sugars added in. Notice how much is saturated fat. And again, as we go through the food guide or the food label, that's going to be drawn out in itself. And then amount, look at the serving size. The fourth message was shift to healthier foods and beverages. Again, you don't have to throw out everything you have in your refrigerator and pantry, but as you buy new, shift to those healthier options, both food and beverages. And then lastly, support healthy eating patterns for all. So that's looking at eating in multiple settings, whether you're eating at home or out, whether you are looking at your community, what's available for you to access there, what's in the grocery stores, in the markets, do you have a farmer's market nearby? And so really looking at healthy foods accessible to all. All right, so those are some of those big messages. And then of course, really looking at My Plate as that visual tool that we can all remember. I do have a video for us to start off this morning. Again, looking at Choose My Plate, the dietary guidelines. So let's go to our first video clip.
Welcome to the ACI Wellness Workshop. Today we'll be talking about the latest dietary methods used to promote healthy eating habits called Choose My Plate. Choose My Plate illustrates the five food groups needed to provide the necessary building blocks for healthy eating. These include fruits, vegetables, grains, protein-rich foods, and low-fat dairy. Fruits and vegetables should account for just over half of the food on your plate, with vegetables making up the slightly larger portion. Vegetables include everything from eggplant, broccoli, and bell peppers to spinach, lettuce, and squash. The best rule for choosing which vegetables to eat is simple. Boost variety and eat as many colors as possible. This ensures that the body receives the optimal amount of vital nutrients, vitamins, and antioxidants. When preparing vegetables, try and eat them lightly grilled or raw if possible. Oversteaming vegetables is a common mistake and causes the vegetables to lose most of their nutrients. With fruits, it's important to boost the variety and diversify the colors as well. They are an excellent standalone option to eat raw or cut up in a fruit salad, and they also act as an excellent complement to sweeten up a salad or entree. Brightly colored fruits such as raspberries and blueberries are also very high in antioxidants that work to inhibit the development of heart disease and certain types of cancer. Next, we have the grain portion of the Choose My Plate model. Grains are an important part of the healthy diet as they supply complex carbohydrates and contain a significant amount of fiber with little fat and no cholesterol. Grains should make up about a quarter of your plate and are found in everything from bread and cereal to pasta and oatmeal. When we think of grains, we usually think of wheat or rice, but options like quinoa, millet, and rolled oats make for even healthier options. With all grains, it's a good rule of thumb to choose whole grains rather than refined or processed grains to make sure the body gets the most nutrients possible. Protein foods will account for the rest of the plate. This includes anything made from meat, poultry, seafood, beans, eggs, processed soy products, nuts, and seeds. From this group, it's better to choose lean or low-fat choices like chicken, fish, and other seafood to ensure minimal intake of cholesterol and saturated fat that often leads to later health issues. The final and smallest portion of the Choose My Plate dietary method is the dairy portion. This includes all fluid milk products and foods that are made from milk like low-fat cheese and yogurt that retain calcium content as well as calcium-fortified soy milk. This does not include foods made from milk with little to no calcium such as butter, cream, and cream cheese. It is important to try and eat around 1 cup per meal of low-fat dairy, which is equivalent to 1 8-ounce glass of milk, 1 regular container of low-fat yogurt, or 1 1.5 ounces of hard cheese to ensure the optimal health benefits. With the new Choose My Plate dietary guidelines, the delectable possibilities for nutritious meals are endless. Take what you've learned today and stock that fridge full of the best foods that your body needs.
Okay, so another review, Choose My Plate. So now you've read it several times, you've heard it, you've seen it presented in a few different ways. I hope it's really sticking. All right, let's move on. And I've already referenced the importance of food labels, but let's talk about reading food labels. A skill that we assume we all have, but what I find is that as I talk with folks about their use of food labels, very few people read food labels on a consistent basis. And I think, you know, it's the best way to get accurate information about what you are eating, if nothing else, to raise your own awareness of what it is you are taking in. Food labels are regulated by the Food and Drug Administration and provide us with a lot of information. So what I'd like to do is to start out with a video clip, and then we'll dissect each section of that nutrition facts label. Okay, so our second video. So happy munching, right? Okay, now let's just go back and look again at that food label. So what we're going to do is we're going to pull this up full screen and just do a quick review of what was presented in that video clip. First thing we always look at is serving size. So very top, take a look at that. Serving size on this particular label is 1 cup. In the container, there are about 2 servings. But how often do we eat the entire container. So if we are eating the entire container, we really have to recalculate some numbers. Because, Because the second thing you're going to look at are the calories, right there. Calories are identified per serving. So if this particular label says 240 calories, an entire container is twice that because it's about two servings. So 480, that's a significant difference. This section here in yellow, total fat, cholesterol, and sodium. Remember, those are those nutrients that we need to limit. I mean, they're all, you know, we need some fat in our diet. I need a little bit of sodium, but this is where oftentimes we as Americans get too much of. Of particular note here is this saturated fat and trans fat. Remember, those are the two that you really want to limit. So that's that section where we really want to limit. This section is where we want to make sure we get enough of. Specifically, dietary fiber, and then down here, the vitamins. Here you will find proteins. So this is where we really talk about nutrient density. If we have quite a bit of this, we are actually getting more in that serving of food. When these numbers tend to be low, you're looking at something that we would call nutrient light. Now, this little column here I've already referred to, that percent daily value. This is what helps us make sense of these listings here. Percent daily value is based on a 2,000 calorie diet. And these are kind of the health recommendations. What we want to do is to make sure that the ones we are limiting are between 0 and maybe 10-15%. We want these to be a higher percentage. So we want more of these and less of that. So that's kind of a way to guide you. This particular product has a lot of calcium in it. It's got no dietary fiber. It's got a lot of sodium, and it's got a fair amount of saturated fat. So while this has some good nutrients, it also has some of those that we want to limit. So we'd want to be cautious about how much of this product we actually ate. Please take a look at the footnote on your labels, basically giving you information about what's in that product and the calorie based on the calorie diet. So here you've got a 2,000 calorie diet. Here you've got the 2,500. So it gives you a little perspective for those folks who are eating different amounts of foods, who require different amounts. Okay, and then the other thing that you want to make sure you do is to look at the ingredient list on a product. It is not part of the nutrition facts label itself. It's another section. And what you really want to do is to look at those first few ingredients. Manufacturers are required to list the ingredients in order of amounts, percentages. So those first few ingredients is really going to tell you what's the primary basis of that product. So if you are reading things like sucrose, fructose, maltose, lactose, hydrogenated oils, this, you're seeing a lot of those sugars. Those are the things that you don't want. You want to see whole grain. You want to see the fruit or the vegetable itself there. And really look at all that's in that product. One of the things I always told kids is if you have difficulty pronouncing the ingredients in that ingredients list, probably you could choose something else with a few less chemicals added to it. So let's go on and pull up this screen. This was also referred in the video clip that we took a look at. There are some new food labels coming. And as a matter of fact, on some products, you will already see the new label. These new labels reconfigure what catches your eye. Serving size is definitely highlighted. Calories highlighted. It takes up a bigger part of that visual, so you really see what it is you are getting. First thing on the list are the servings per container. So if you read even from top to bottom, the first thing is you're going to see how much is in that package. So this new label is scheduled to come out in 2018, summer of. Yet we already see a lot of manufacturers have moved to the new label. So that's a good thing. What I do want to add to that is in the new label, we are going to see a new component, and that is added sugar. And this is the first time added sugars have been listed in a food label. And it really is to help us make some of those decisions about limiting fat, sugars, and some of those extra things that we don't need. Excuse me. So what I have for you is a video clip. It's entitled What the Sugar Industry Doesn't Want You to Know. And I think when we highlight something that is an industry unto itself, we may actually have some folks concerned about that. But let's take a look at this video clip and see what they say.
The FDA recommends 300 grams of carbs a day, 2.4 of sodium, and 65 for fat. But sugar? I have no idea. And that's probably because the industry doesn't want me to. I read nutrition labels. Almost all nutrients have a percent daily value that gives consumers a yardstick for how much they should be eating or drinking. Sugar stands out because it doesn't have one.
Because the food industry fought against it. The sugar industry is very good at lobbying and very, very good at getting what it wants.
Turns out soda companies in the sugar lobby have spent at least $168 million fighting measures like sugar taxes since 2009. Right now, the industry wants the Federal Food and Drug Administration to drop a proposal for labeling sugar. The agency thinks the added information will actually discourage the average American from eating more than 50 grams of sugar a day.
Most Americans eat twice the amount of sugar than this particular cap.
And Americans aren't overdosing on fruit. They're getting high on added sugar. We're not just talking soda and ice cream. Ketchup.
4 grams of sugar per tablespoon.
Salad dressing, tomato sauce. Even cereals that are marketed as healthy.
That means this is 24%, a quarter of the amount of sugar that you're allowed to have for an entire day.
Fruit juices.
Orange juice has as much sugar in it as a soft drink.
And how about this one? Bread. But I looked here, wheat flour, eggs. Sugar is the third ingredient.
So every one of these has 10% of the day's sugar allotment. I bet they're delicious.
Hypothetically, you can have a cup of this, a cup of this, a teaspoon of that, this, a cup of this, and you're maxed out for the day.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
I mean, easily,
with no
right?
trouble at all. So that's why food companies are so opposed to having this daily value on the food label, because they know that customers will be shocked when they see how much sugar there is in products that, where they might not have suspected.
The Sugar Association wrote a 17-page letter to the FDA saying that added sugars have the same chemical makeup as naturally occurring ones, pointing out that the term added sugars is misleading and without scientific justification. So where does all this leave the FDA's new sugar labels? Well, if history is any guide, the industry will press its case hard. It blocked measures to limit sugar in several states and cities. The most recent? Last year, in San Francisco, where lobbyists for Big Soda spent $9 million to defeat a proposed sugar tax. All this means the FDA's proposal is probably toast, the one with the added sugar.
All right, so we don't know what will happen in the future. We don't know if the added sugar will stay on the label or will come off. At this point, those companies that are complying with the new label already are identifying that. So be aware. Take a look at the labels that you see on those products that you purchase. Now, granted, there are some things that you may purchase that don't have a label. When you are purchasing fresh meat, produce, you can always go to the USDA's website and put in nutrition facts, and that will lead you to the page where you can find the nutrition facts on any product, both manufactured and grown natural. So it'll be something interesting to watch over the next year or so, because we do know that food industry lobbies are incredibly powerful, and they really do try to shape what we are eating and drinking to benefit their industry, of course. But it's the idea about at least knowing what it is we are consuming. We're not saying you don't have to, you have to ban it all. What we're saying is be aware, be knowledgeable, make healthy choices based on accurate information. So we know that we have the potential to read labels. There's another part of our daily existence now that influences our healthy eating, and that is the whole issue of fast food. You know, we have become a fast food nation. You know, you look at some of the labels behind me and you will recognize all, if not most of them, because in our culture we have this increased reliance on these fast foods. You know, a lot of people refer to this as junk food. It is a judgment call. You can make some healthy choices at these locations. So I just prefer to stay with fast food, because literally that's what we're doing, is we're trying to get our food quickly so we can get to the next soccer game, appointment, class, whatever. In the 1970s, there was about an 18% use of fast foods in a regular basis. That was a treat to go to a fast food location. In the 90s, it bumped up to 32%. I haven't seen a number recently, but my guess is that many of us have even a greater reliance on fast food than we used to. Typically, in fast food products, you see higher fat, higher salt concentrations, and more of that hidden sugar. We also see larger portions, and we consume that food typically much quicker than we would a meal, sit down at a table. We also have to realize the economics of the fast food industry. We know that it is convenient for us, but it is also expensive. For the amount of money that you spend buying meals for a family of four through a fast food chain, you can purchase a fair amount of groceries for that. But again, it's that convenience of already prepared food. We don't have to sit in our kitchens and cook. And we can move much faster through our day. I encourage you, knowing that we all visit fast food locations, to look at the food labels for each of their products. Oftentimes when you go through the drive-thru or you're standing at the counter, they may have their nutrition labels available for you then. If they do not, you can certainly go online to any of the companies, and they are required to post the nutrient content of each of their food items. So take a look at what it is you routinely select, what is the fat content, the salt content, the sugar content, where are the nutrients in that, what is it showing a good amount of, and then look around on that label, on those menus, and see if you might be able to find some healthier options. Again, remembering that shift to healthier foods and beverages, so that, you know, we, one, become aware of what we're putting in our bodies, and two, can make some informed decisions about that. So let's move on from fast foods, and let's now talk about sugar-sweetened beverages. Again, this is something that is pervasive in our culture. We typically don't grab for our bottle of water or a container of milk. We grab for one of these. And you've seen these sitting on my table all morning, thinking, what are they and why does she have them there? So what I'd like to do is just use the nutrition label on each of these products to look at how much sugar is here. Before I do that, I just want to throw out a very quick public service announcement for how much sugar is in soda. So we wouldn't eat those packs of sugar, but many of us consume a lot of those sugar-sweetened beverages. So let's just take a look at some of the labels here. Okay, this is Golden Bear's lemonade with ginseng and honey. We think, oh, good, honey, that's a good thing, right? When I look at the label, and it goes all the way down the side of the can, I see it's 10% juice, so it says it's lemonade, so only 10% to lemonade, or to the lemon juice. When I look at the ingredients list, I'm looking at filtered water, high fructose corn syrup, that is a glucose fructose syrup, so a sugar, lemon juice, pear juice, then it's got some natural flavors, and then it's got honey, which is a sugar. It's got sucralose in it, another sugar, sucrose, another sugar. So it's pretty heavily dosed in sugar. So let's look at the calories and what it is. 70 calories, but there are 3 servings in this container. Well, how many of us would share this with our 2 best friends? Most likely we are drinking the whole thing. So if there's 70 servings per container, there's 210 for the entire container. What I really want to look at are the sugars. Because this is not a heavy juice drink, most of these sugars are going to be added sugars. 18 grams of sugar. So how do we translate grams into something we all know? Teaspoons. 1 teaspoon is the equivalent of 4 grams. So if this has 18 grams, 18 divided by 4 is 4.5. So per serving, we have 4, and here's my little half teaspoon, 4.5 teaspoons of sugar per serving. All right, so if we take that and we're going to drink the whole can, we are going to end up with 13.5 teaspoons of sugar. So there's my 13 sugar cubes, which is 1.5 teaspoons. How many of us would actually drink or eat all of this sugar? Yet we drink it, right? And now that's okay if you are doing that, making a conscious decision. But a lot of folks say, oh, it's lemonade. It's got honey. It's got ginseng. It must be okay. It's a really heavy sugar drink. How many of us aspire to be that super athlete and we need to drink Gatorade? It's a thirst quencher. A lot of folks will say, oh, it's replacing the electrolytes that I lose, in activity. All right, well, this is, according to its label, 1 serving. So this is a pretty small bottle. I see a lot of folks with a much larger container. There are 29 grams of sugar in this container. So 29 divided by 4. We're looking at about 7 teaspoons. 7 times 4 is 28, right? 7 teaspoons of sugar in something that many folks consider a healthy beverage. It's that hidden sugar that we talk about. Energy drinks have been, and I guess continue to be, something that is of interest to folks. This is a Monster, and this can is actually 2 servings. So how many folks share this with a friend? Not many that I know of. Interesting on this label is it actually has the nutrient facts per serving and the nutrient facts per container, so per the can. So 210 calories for the entire can and 54 grams of sugar. 54 divided by 4. We are looking at, again, 13.5 grams of sugar. 13.5 teaspoons of sugar, sorry. If you are drinking that whole can. All right. So yes, you're getting a lot of energy out of that, and that is from refined sugar. Remember we talked last week about energy sources, and carbohydrates do provide us that energy. There are simple sugars and there are complex sugars. So fortunately, this one has only the simple sugars in it. So it will be a fast rush of energy and then it's done. A lot of folks I see walking around with vitamin water. Sounds so healthy, doesn't it? It's water, we're promoting drinking water, and it's got vitamins added. Well, what else does it have in here? There is no juice in this, it's all flavorings. 120 calories for vitamin water. 32 grams of sugar. 32 divided by 4 is 8. Oops. So, in our effort to make a healthy choice and to drink vitamin water, we're actually consuming 8 teaspoons of sugar. This is one that has always surprised me, was Capri Sun, because I see this on the soccer field. I see this in kids' lunchboxes. And we think we are giving our kids a healthy beverage. It's fruit punch. I've seen orange flavors. I've seen berry flavors. But key to the looking at what's printed on this is this is a flavored juice drink blend. A flavored juice drink blend. On the back, I learned that it's only 10% juice. So what else is in here? We have water, high fructose corn syrup, apple and grape juice concentrate. There's some pineapple juice concentrate in there, but we are looking at added sugars, 33 grams. So this one has a little bit more sugar than the vitamin water. So these two, which we often see folks drinking, both have pretty straight sugar. It's not too many nutrients in that. And then, of course, a soda. I think a lot of us have heard the messages about the sugars in sodas. So we are much more aware. A can of, this is 7-Up, has 38 grams of sugar. When you look at the other nutrients, no fat, it has a little bit of sodium, no protein, no vitamins, so you really are drinking sugar water here. And this ends up to be about 9.5 teaspoons of sugar in a can of 7-Up. So again, it's information that we seek. I'm not saying don't ever drink any of these again, but shift to healthier beverages. Healthier beverages being water, low-fat or non-fat milks, 100% juice if you're going to drink juice. Just be very aware. Now, I do want to just mention my friend here, a naked juice drink. All right, so this is 100% juice smoothie. Okay, so that sounds good. It's flavored 4 juice blends with other natural flavors and ingredients, and there on the label, no sugar added. So the sugars in this all come from fruits. Well, so here we go, 23 grams of sugar. 23 divided by 4, you still are ending up with you're ending up with the equivalent of almost 6 teaspoons of sugar. Now, it's not added sugar. So that kind of goes back to that comment that Marion Nestles made in that video clip, is juices have about the same amount of sugars as sodas. Again, you just want to limit even your consumption of fruits, because in this one drink, you are getting 21 strawberries, 2 apples, 3 bananas, and a hint of orange. Typically, we don't eat as much fruit as we drink. And when we eat the fruit, we are getting the fibers that we need. So even with something like this, you want to make some very informed decisions. So watch what you not only eat, but drink, and look out for those hidden sugars. All right, so now that you're all wondering, oh my gosh, what's in my refrigerator or what's in my pantry, I do hope I've spurred your interest, that you will look at labels a little bit more closely so that you know what it is you are consuming. When you then know what it is you are consuming, you can make some decisions about what you want to decrease or increase, and you can set some goals for yourself. That is the same thing that we do with students when we teach them how to read a food label, so that they can make some decisions and say, wow, I drink 3 or 4 of these a day. Maybe I should replace that with some healthier beverages. Maybe just drink one of those a day. And so set a goal. That's decreasing a lot of that added sugar consumption, replacing it with a healthier beverage. That's a good thing. And that's really how we have to go through life, is looking at what we're doing, how do we do it better, how do we become more conscious about what goes into our bodies, food and drink, and then what are our choices. So I hope that you can take some of this information and help your students learn how to use it. The other thing that I want to remind you of is the size or the quantity of what we eat. We have to talk about portion size. The average restaurant meal today is 4 times the size that it was in the 1950s. That's not because we need 4 times the amount of food. We were probably much more active in the 50s than we are today. Correspondingly, with that increase in portion size, on average now we know that adults are 25 to 30 pounds heavier than they were in the 1950s. So again, even with our portions, we want to look at what is a serving. Rather than drink a whole can of these, which would be multiple servings, can we drink less? Instead of eating large portions of a meal, can we eat less? So let's look at how portions have changed over time. I've got another video clip for you. Okay, and we thought we were just getting a better deal on food, right? So very often we go into a restaurant and if the serving looks small, we feel slighted. But yet, over time, those servings have grown exponentially. And that, it means that we are getting probably more of those saturated fats, more sodium, and more of that hidden sugar in all of those foods. Remember, thinking back to that video, breads have a lot of hidden sugar, as does the pasta sauce. Certainly, we all think about a blueberry muffin being very a healthy choice for breakfast. Maybe not. So again, look at labels, look at portion size, let those guide your choices. Those are the things that we also need to teach our kids, because the more we do that at an earlier age, the more likely we are to continue that. And as we talk more about making healthy choices, becomes a personal control issue, and it's about what I want for my body, for my life. And I think that's a good thing to let kids take on. So That's just a little bit this morning to continue our discussion on nutrition. And I think it's time for a break. Hopefully during break, you can actually drink a healthier beverage, make a healthy snack, and get a little bit of physical activity. Come back in 10 minutes and we're going to talk a little bit more about nutrition, and then we're going to switch to that other side of the coin and talk about physical activity. So I will see you all back here in 10 minutes. Take care.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it, the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Zenaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mara Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
Maybe you know how to use some of these platforms, but do you know how to make them work for your business interests? Most programs tell you to start with great content, but do they tell you how to create that great content? Creating effective content that can build a viral momentum is the hardest part of social media marketing. That's where we come in. The Certificate Program in Social Media Strategies and Content Marketing is a content-based course of study. During this 48-hour intensive immersion program, you will learn how to understand why some content goes viral while other content fails to gain traction. Identify your target audience, connect with them, and build them into a community. Create content that is specifically designed to inspire a positive emotional response and encourage engagement with your target audience. Distribute your content across the social platforms that are most appropriate for your specific goals. Become a thought leader in your area of expertise. This program is designed to help business owners, artists, and other creatives promote their professional ventures. If you're employed in public relations, advertising, marketing, journalism, publishing, education, or government affairs, this certificate can give you a professional edge toward promotions. If you're seeking employment in these areas, this certificate will let corporate recruiters know that you understand the importance of social media literacy. Enroll now.
For a $250,000 equity investment in my company, in return you'll get 10%.
How are we going to fund this? We are going to be a nonprofit organization. We are looking to the Gates Foundation to help us cover our costs.
What we'd like to do is to bring out a product, a video game, that we can bring to market that will have educational value and what we like to call is edutainment.
Money is going to be used for retail stores, so 50% strictly for retail store inventory, another 20% for retail marketing support.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school is for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Welcome you to our campus, the campus of California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm Dr. Hamden, and it gives me great pleasure today to welcome you to our very first STEM in Action event. All right, let the fun begin. There we go. Time of your life today. As I look at you, I look at the future doctors, the future astronauts, the future math and science teachers. We'll be right back. This is where STEM happens. This is where STEM comes alive.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, welcome back to Health Science 300, Health in Public Education. We are starting the second hour of our two-hour broadcast. And we've spent the first hour talking a quick review of the dietary guidelines, but then looking at food labels and what do they tell us? What about those hidden fats, sugars, salts? How can they help us make choices about the foods we eat, whether we're preparing them at home or eating them on the run, and the beverages that we consume? You know, I think we often want to say, well, it's because of our lifestyle, the increased reliance on sugar-sweetened beverages and fast foods and our decreased physical activity that's leading to this obesity epidemic. And we know that those are all factors in that issue. So in an effort to fight the issue of obesity, and we know that being obese, overweight, is hard on the body, we often try to do a quick fix. And so what I want to remind you about so that you can have conversations with your students is to avoid those fad diets. You know, it takes a while, it takes a period of time eating those calorie-dense foods over time. It takes a period of time of not engaging in physical activity to show that increase in weight. So it is not something that we can just get rid of in a few days. And yet so many people, you know, strive for that quick fix. And we will believe any promises that are made to us. While most diets are geared to adults, kids see these same commercials. Kids hear adults talk about dieting. So they very often are picking up on these same behaviors. We see kids who are focused on eating only a particular food item. I'm going to eat carrots all week. Well, carrots are great, but they don't provide all the nutrients they need, as does the grapefruit diet or the boiled egg diet or eating straight meat proteins all week. You know, you can take a good food and perseverate on it so much that it now is not a healthy choice for you, because we do need that variety. You know, there are a lot of folks who are listening to commercials around diet pills, herbal supplements. We know that those are not shown, there is no evidence that those are effective as far as long-term healthy weight loss. Some of them can actually be pretty dangerous to individuals if you already have an existing health condition. We know that there are individuals who go on these crash diets, very restrictive, low-calorie diets. And really what that does is it kicks into our brain, oh my gosh, they are starving themselves. We need to slow down the metabolism. We'll burn up muscle tissue because the fat tissue is no longer there. So those extreme low-calorie diets are not a healthy option. Those diets that focus on one macronutrient, either as good or bad. A few years back, low-carb diets were the rage. And we need those carbs for energy. We need those complex carbs in particular. We need that fiber. We've seen high-protein diets where we get an inordinate amount of protein. Our body does not need that protein in that quantity. We actually can exacerbate gout, kidney stones. It damages the kidneys to go into that high protein diet for an extended period of time, and even has some interplay in osteoporosis. So rather than focus on that quick fix, we really need to think about shifting to those healthier foods and beverages. I also want to just throw out a word of caution that food quackery is not only seen in the dieting world, but far beyond. And, you know, when we look at advertisements, we see a lot of advertisements around natural products or health food products. I hope that through this course, you're all learning to become good consumers and that you share that educational aspect with students. We really need to look at the advertising. What are they trying to sell us? We need to read the labels. That provides us with accurate, current information about that food product. We need to be up on the research and getting our research from reputable sources. So thinking back to that accessing valid information skill, using something like the CRAAP test to say, is this a source of information that is recognized? And then also make sure we read precautions. A while back, bee pollen has been marketed as a health food that, you know, everyone should eat because it's really good for you. Yet those with severe allergies will not want to have that because it'll cause a severe reaction. You know, that is often buried in the research, on the labels, in any discussions about the benefits of a product. So we really need to look closely, read carefully, because we cannot fix quickly what we have taken time to degrade. So there's part of all of that discussion for you. So how do we do all of this with our kids? And really, I want to just take a few minutes to focus on nutrition education in the classroom. How do we talk about foods in a classroom? First and foremost, make sure that you have accurate current information. Make sure that the instructional resources you are using are current and relevant. And use these health education standards to guide you. They will identify what students should know and be able to do in those appropriate grade levels. Certainly in your textbook, you have the national health education standards there at the back of the chapter and some suggested strategies and assessments. Take a look at some of those. See if some of those might be things that you can adapt for your classroom. But look carefully at the California standards for nutrition and physical activity for your grade level. If you find that there are no nutrition and physical activity standards for your grade level, look at the grade level below. Look at the grade level above. What were students supposed to learn before they came into your grade? Is there anything you can reinforce there? What should you prepare your students for in the next grade level? So those are things that you can do as far as the standards. There's a couple of resources I also want to point you to. And so if we could go back to my computer screen here on the desk. There are some great resources identified on the choosemyplate.gov website. So again, go back here, go to My Plate. Lots of information about the food groups, etc. Healthy eating style. And than some of those, quote, popular topics around eating on a budget and those tip sheets. So that is a resource for you to look at current, accurate information that can be translated to our students. And you can also look up by state, some My Plate, My State, and see what's happening here in California and in other parts of the country as far as resources. Okay, so that's Choose My Plate. Another resource I want to remind you of is the Let's Move website. Let's Move, if you just put in your Google search, Let's Move, you will end up on this page. This was an active governmental site. It used to be letsmove.gov. It is now archived under the Obama White House. So it's frozen in time. So some of the links may no longer work. But the Let's Move campaign was introduced to you in your textbook. And there's still a lot of good information here on healthy eating, on physical activity. And remember that one of the cornerstones of the Let's Move campaign was instituting gardening. Gardening is a great way to grow plants that are edible. So we see that whole process from growth to harvest. And it's also a great physical activity. So you might want to take a look at the gardening section of the Let's Move site. Another resource that you will want to check out is Team Nutrition. And again, this is on the USDA's website. Team Nutrition has lesson plans, recipes, back to school resources, again, all focused on My Plate. Lots of resources that you can order, and as a teacher, those are available to you, and many in Spanish language. So take a look at Team Nutrition. And then one more website I want to show you to support your nutrition education in the classroom is the Dairy Council of California. And the website is healthyeating.org. I mentioned this one last week, but I did want to again highlight it because what I want you to do is click on the school link. And here are nutrition resources for educators, their classroom programs, teacher training. They've got just an abundance of information here. So, you know, take advantage of that now. In California, as a teacher, these resources are free to you. They have some instructional materials that are great for families and parents. Take a look at that and see how you can weave those into the work you do with the students in your classroom. Okay, and oh, one more, Kids Health. I've mentioned this one before. Go onto the educators site. Right here are teachers' guides by varying grade levels. You click on one of those, you will see where those lesson plans lead you. Human body health problems, personal health. And under personal health, there's fitness, there's screen time, and there's nutrition. Everything from breakfast to snacking to lunch. So have fun exploring some of those sites. See what you can find to enhance your nutrition education in your classroom. All right, and I want to acknowledge Narita is with us again. Good morning, glad you are here. Narita says, in response to our questions of the day, Narita says, the truth is that I was not aware of the importance of talking about health and promoting health lifestyles for my students. Now that I know how crucial it is for kids to become conscious about their healthy eating, I will integrate this idea into my classroom about talking about it, by talking about it, creating lessons that address healthy choices. The majority of my students would benefit from this because they are significantly impacted by the unhealthy choices they are making. Most of my students eat chips, sodas, and juice for breakfast and throughout the day. This week, one of my students walked into class with a liter bottle of Sprite in the morning, making me aware that the lesson planning around the topic of health is needed. I can certainly help students by making healthy choices myself and spending time reading those nutrition labels. Wow, thank you for sharing that. Sometimes we don't think about it. And so if anything, I hope that this class raises your awareness of some of the conversations we can have with kids. I mean, here, you know, I've given you some resources with full-blown lesson plans, but you can have conversations about foods. You can talk about what's on the school lunch menu. Classify those food items into their corresponding groups. Talk about, well, what would you choose if you don't want to choose that product? Look at having kids look in their own pantries and find healthy choices and maybe a few less healthy choices. How can they talk to parents about choosing more healthy foods? Those are all great things to do. And I like the fact, Narita, that you brought out modeling healthy eating yourself. Our kids watch what we do. If we are eating chips and drinking sodas at our desk, that reinforces some of those messages that kids get. So let's think about what we are doing as models. Okay, so thank you so much for sharing. I appreciate that. I'm excited that you want to take the plunge and jump in, and I wish you the best of success. All right, in addition to what we do with nutrition education in the classroom, I also want us to all focus on healthy eating instead of weight. You know, we started out this content area talking about weight. We're talking about the obesity issues, how many of our students are overweight or obese. And, you know, sometimes that conversation says, oh my gosh, well, what do I need to do to go on my diet? And what do I do with my kids? How can I put them on a diet? Well, I want you to lose the diet concept. But I want you to look at this next video and how they approach that concept. It's entitled, How to Put Your Child on a Diet. I think you'll be surprised at what that looks like. Let's take a look.
How to Put Your Child on a Diet. Although childhood obesity is becoming a national epidemic, you can use several strategies to help your child overcome a weight problem and lead a healthy life. You will need healthy foods, activities that promote exercise, and scheduled eating times. Optional, professional help. Always consult a physician before attempting any exercise or exercise plan. Step 1. Focus on healthy foods rather than putting your child on a strict diet. Eliminate high-calorie fillers and substitute healthy foods, such as raw vegetables in place of fried foods. Seek professional help if your child has an eating disorder or is obese. Step 2. Plan activities that keep your child moving and physically engaged, such as summer camp, karate class, dancing, or sports. Step 3. Share a balanced meal as a family and then shift to a fun activity like playing a game or going for a walk. Limit sedentary time with the TV, video games, and computers to a few hours a day. Step 4. Institute regular meal and snack times and restrict all-day snacking. Step 5. Eat right and exercise, and your child will more easily adopt a healthy lifestyle by following your lead. Did you know? One study found that 25% of obese adults were overweight as children.
Okay, so that's a healthy approach to putting your child on a diet. It really is about selecting healthy foods, engaging in physical activity, and having some set times where we focus on eating rather than eating all day. We also want to avoid conversations about good foods and bad foods. I really don't want us to demonize any food. And I think we've done a pretty good job of that with sodas and fast food. But rather treat them as, rather than junk food or bad foods, those are special occasion foods. We can have a little bit once in a while, as long as our once in a while doesn't come too often. And let's lose the diet talk. Oh, I've got a big meeting next month. I want to look my best. I need to lose some weight before I go. Or I'm going to a party. I need to wear something that makes me look thinner. Because kids pick up on those conversations. And we are hearing kids in those early grades in elementary school talking about being too fat. I need to lose weight. I need to be skinny. I need to go on a diet. And that shouldn't be a conversation that those little ones are having. Just focus on healthy foods, healthier choices, special occasion foods, and lots of physical activity. And that's how we can replace that diet talk. Okay, so that I just want to kind of sum up all of that with nutrition. You know, we've talked about what we should be eating. We've talked about the influences on our eating behaviors. And we certainly have a lot of information at our fingertips. So we want to read that information to help us make healthy decisions, set some healthy goals for ourselves, and engage in a wide variety of healthy eating behaviors. So let's talk a little bit in our remaining time together about physical activity. You know, physical activity is critical to good health. Physical activity reduces the risk of many chronic diseases and premature death. So just for that fact alone, we ought to be up and active. It does help us reduce weight. It improves our cardiovascular function. It enhances our bone density, helps us get stronger bones, and it helps us sleep better. Okay, so we've already talked about some of those issues in prior sessions. So what better way to address some of those issues than by physical activity? Unfortunately, in this country, many adults do not get enough physical activity. More than 60% of adults, especially women, the elderly, and those in low socioeconomic areas, do not get the recommended amount of physical activity. And we certainly know that activity, time, and intensity tends to decrease as children grow into adolescents who grow into adults. So over time, we engage in less and less activity. I mean, think about those little ones. They are moving all the time. I'm not talking about physical education. I'm not talking about sports or athletics. I'm talking just about movement, physical activity. We are sitting a lot, aren't we? So if we as adults are not getting enough, I can pretty much guarantee that kids are not either. The recommended amount of physical activity for adults is 30 minutes of moderate to vigorous physical activity every day. Only 30 minutes. You don't even have to get that all in one fell swoop. For kids, that recommendation is 60 minutes. And that is not only for the young ones, but all the way through adolescence, 60 minutes a day. Most kids are not getting that, as most adults are not getting it. Research has shown that there is certainly a link between physical activity and academic performance. So if the health component doesn't get you, hopefully this one will, because as a classroom teacher, you know, we want our kids to do well academically. Research shows that physical activity is linked to improved academic performance. It helps our students with increased attention span, concentration, positive attitudes about learning, resulting in those improved test scores. And certainly that is what we are frequently judged on. More and more teachers are starting to include short physical activity breaks in the classroom and outside the classroom. So we all recognize that physical activity increases heart rate, causes deeper breathing, which of course means that we are increasing our oxygenated blood flow. So we are providing that blood to the brain so that it can do the work we ask it to do. We also know that increased physical activity also improves behavior, even among those young children diagnosed with ADHD. So if we want to help our kids achieve academically, we need to get them moving. Now, does that mean that we lose instructional time? Not at all. You know, there are ways that we can get in those short bursts of physical activity while doing something else, or during a transition period from one activity to another. We can engage our students in a variety of postures. Get them up walking and talking. They can lean, they can perch, they can squat. All of those different positions are using different muscles, which means physical activity. We can have our students engaged in movement, whether that is dance or pantomime, or just, as I said, the walk and talk. You know, we do a lot of share with your neighbor what you just learned. Well, have them stand up and share with their neighbor. That's using different muscles. Have them walk around the room. Many teachers use a gallery walk of, you know, posting student work up throughout the room so that students can walk and see each other's work. We can encourage our students to use their bodies to learn, to demonstrate concepts, words, or rhythms. Incorporate role play in what you do. Again, it is movement. And then don't forget to have students stand and stretch about every 20 minutes just to energize. So we really don't even have to take away lots of instructional time to do that activity. When you notice your students are nodding off, you've talked too long, right? Get them up, stretch, move, turn, cross midline, anything to get that activity. That's going to certainly help them achieve academically. Now, there are certain factors that influence physical activity, and we need to recognize those. First, when we talk about these factors, we need to recognize the demographics issue. Girls, adolescents, and non-Caucasian students typically get less physical activity than boys, young children, and Caucasian students. So we need to think about our audience. We need to make sure that they are up and physically active. Another one of the factors that influences how much physical activity we engage in is our own perception of benefits. Is it good for me to be physically active? I don't know, it's not that big of a deal. Then we're more likely to sit. However, if we really perceive that being physically active is beneficial, we're more likely to engage in that. Remember that first, second or third broadcast, we talked about behavior change. We have to perceive that it is beneficial before we actually change a behavior. We also need the support of friends and family. If your friends and family don't support you, you are likely to go back to those unhealthy behaviors. So those are some of the factors that we need to consider as far as demographics and personal perception. We also recognize that housing patterns play a role in the amount of our physical activity. You know, for so many of us, we live in neighborhoods where we have to have a car to get the things that we need, the grocery store, going to school, etc. We may not have a park in our neighborhood, in our immediate neighborhood, so we feel we actually have to drive someplace to go to the park. And in many communities, walking and bicycling are not promoted, and they might even be discouraged because the streets are not safe, the sidewalks are in disrepair. So often where we live influences our physical activity. Safety concerns, a big factor in influencing our activity levels. If parents are concerned about their child playing outside and not being safe, they're not going to want their kids to go outside. Okay, so then we just have to think about, okay, what can we do to be physically active inside? You know, there are lots of parents who say, I don't want my kids out when I'm not right there with them. Okay, so that's a great opportunity for families to get physical activity, but you have to brainstorm some things to do when mom and dad are not available. We also have to recognize that there is a whole lot of appealing technology out there. It is so much more fun to sit in front of your computer, to play those games, to watch those videos or television shows, then get up and go for a walk. And the technology is so available and accessible to us. Sometimes we not only have it in the living room, but in every bedroom, and then there's a TV in the kitchen. And so we have made it so accessible and so appealing that we are choosing that rather than physical activity. So we need to limit screen time. The other thing that factors in here are limited facilities. I talked about some neighborhoods don't have parks. And sometimes when they do have parks or fitness centers or activity recreation centers, they may be in disrepair. They certainly have often been affected by budget cuts. And so there are times when going to that park is just not appealing at all. There's nothing to do there because everything is broken or it's dirty, it's not kept up. So certainly we need to look around us and look at some of those factors that influence our ability to be physically active. And when we get to that point, we do that assessment, then we've got to identify some alternatives. You know, I've been doing a lot of talk about physical activity, and I want to just make sure we are all on the same page as far as some definitions. So when I keep referring to physical activity, that is any movement produced by skeletal muscles, which results in the expenditure of energy. So that can be walking, that can be gardening, that can be dancing. Any and all of that is physical activity, as is doing your calisthenics or taking a run or a bicycle ride. All of that is muscle movement, right? So it's all under that umbrella of physical activity. Oftentimes when we talk about promoting physical activity, people say, you know, I just hate to exercise. Well, exercise is a different concept. Exercise is that planned, structured, and repetitive movement to improve or maintain physical fitness. So, okay, you don't like to do the repetitive movements, then find an activity that you enjoy. You don't have to do jumping jacks. You don't have to do push-ups. You can engage those muscles in lots of other different types of activity. So don't get stuck in, I don't like exercise, therefore I am not physically active. We do also talk about physical fitness. And physical fitness is health-related or motor skill-related. Physical fitness is really about improving our cardiovascular endurance, our muscle strength and endurance, our flexibility, and ultimately our body composition. That is our goal pretty much of any of this activity and exercise, is that we are doing this to improve our body, the functioning of our heart and lungs, the strength of our muscles. You know, can we move the way we need to move? And what is that? If we are doing all of that, is our body composition in alignment with between height and weight? The last term I want to just highlight is physical education. Because many people in schools think physical activity is physical education. Well, we hope that in physical education, students are active. But physical education is a planned, sequential curriculum that focuses on physical skill development and cognitive learning about fitness. So there's the actual learning of the skills, but also learning the cognitive piece behind why that's important. In California, in grades 1 through 5, the California laws, education laws require 200 minutes of physical education every 10 days. Now again, this is a planned sequential curricula. So physical education should not be free play. There is an instructional component to that. In grades 6 through high school, that's 400 minutes every 10 days. And in all grade levels, half of that time required should be in moderate to vigorous physical activity. So we don't want to be sitting during physical education for more than half of that time. We really do want to get up. We want to engage in the lessons, in the learning, both skill, physical skill and cognitive piece. We are all targeted towards improving physical fitness. And I think the big thing about physical education is it helps our students identify physical activities that they enjoy and will want to do beyond the physical education class time. So it's really about finding things that you enjoy, you like. Now, when we talk about physical activity, we also have some terminology we just need to make sure everybody's aware of. First, there is aerobic physical activity, and that is that moderate intensity. So this is not the casual walk around the mall, but this is where your heart is beating a little bit. You have to breathe a little bit more intensely. That's getting that oxygen flowing. And we need that type of physical activity. We also need muscle strengthening activity. So that can be anything from the tug of war kind of games to push-ups, pull-up, resistance with weights or bands. We need to build muscles and look at all muscle systems. And then we certainly want to also engage in bone strengthening physical activity. So this is the jumping, the running, gymnastics, basketball, volleyball, tennis, things where we are really doing a little bit of pounding. As you get older, you have to be careful with some of that. But looking at what we can do to strengthen our bones, it's that resistance, that impact on our bones that we want to make sure we also address. I am looking for a specific page. Here we go. Page 198 in your textbook has a visual of what's called my activity pyramid. And I just want to remind each of you to take a look specifically at that visual because we are looking at really a blend of a variety of types of activity. We want those everyday lifestyle activities to continue. We want to make sure we do some type of aerobic exercise every day, that we are doing muscle strengthening 2, 3, 4 times a week, and as little inactivity as possible. So really getting up and moving. So can we do it in a school system? Absolutely. Let's take a look at a video called Educating the Student Body and see how we take a look at physical activity and education in school.
Our youth population is suffering from physical inactivity. Over the past 30 to 40 years, the volume and intensity of daily physical activity among youth has gradually declined. In the United States, only about half of youth meet the recommended guideline of at least 60 minutes of vigorous or moderate physical activity each day. A lack of activity increases the risk of heart disease, diabetes, osteoporosis, anxiety and depression, and other diseases. Recent studies have found that in terms of mortality, the global public health burden of physical inactivity approaches that of cigarette smoking and obesity. Physical activity improves other aspects of health and fitness, including aerobic capacity, muscle and bone strength, reduction of anxiety, depression and stress, self-concept, and academic performance. 48 to 69% of students did not attend physical education classes in an average week. Since the passing of the No Child Left Behind Act, nearly half of school administrators reported cutting significant time from physical education and recess to increase time spent in reading and mathematics. Given that children spend up to 7 hours each day in school and many attend after-school programs, it is important to examine the role schools play. The opportunity to influence so many children at once makes schools an extremely attractive option for increasing physical activity. The Institute of Medicine recommends a whole-of-school approach to physical activity, allowing for at least 60 minutes per day of activity that is of vigorous or moderate intensity, where at least half is accomplished during regular school hours and the other half occurs in the school environment. This is where the majority of youth can be reached, regardless of their socioeconomic background. Physical activity should be included in recess, dedicated classroom activity time, active transportation, before and after school programs, intramural and extramural sports, and in physical education classes. Let's educate the student body. For more information,
gives us some concrete ways to incorporate physical activity throughout that school day, both in the classroom and outside the classroom, in physical education and beyond physical education. If you are at a school where those conversations are taking place about, oh, you know, we need more reading time, we need more math time, let's eliminate physical activity. Let's eliminate the physical education time. I think we all need to stand up and be advocates for our kids and say, you know, kids need this. Research shows that time spent in physical education and activity does not diminish the time it takes, the time spent in instructional activities, or the benefit of that. So, by actually adding more instructional time, we may actually be having a harder time reaching our academic goals because our kids need that activity. And I'm sure as many of you look at your students, you know the students who really need that physical activity, those frequent classroom breaks, those we call them brain breaks, or you can call them muscle breaks or whatever, because that helps them refocus. And that continued time on the academic piece, it actually becomes very frustrating then. So I encourage you to be an advocate for physical activity and physical education at your school. So here are a few of the suggestions brought out by the authors of the textbook, and I think you've heard some of these before. One, include activity in the classroom. Even if it's a stretch break, even if it's a quick walk around the room, something to get kids up and moving, to break that monotony of sitting in a position for a while. When you play games with students, play with smaller groups. That means more of the kids can be active. I've observed out on playgrounds a game of kickball. We have one ball and 30 kids, and a lot of them are standing around for a long time. If we have a little bit more equipment, a few more balls, we can break those into smaller groups so that kids are engaging in more activity with a fewer number of students, but more equipment. If you are having kids shoot baskets, the basketball, one basketball for the class is not enough. We need to have multiples. Find games where kids are running and jumping. They love it, and it's really good activity for them. Use music and movement as part of your classroom. And use a variety of musics. Music to calm down, music to liven up, and then corresponding movement. Reinforce those positive attitudes about physical activity. So often I hear adults say, oh, okay, I gotta go to the gym. I guess I can't do that. And it's like, okay, I know it sounds awful. You're not sounding very motivated. Just take a different look at it. Because a lot of times when we have those negative attitudes, they are transmitted to kids. Okay, guys, well, I guess we have to have PE now because we're required to. Kids go, oh. Some of them will. Some of them are so thrilled to have PE. But reinforce those positive attitudes. Remember, that's part of that perception, and it's part of building support for the change in behavior. Please, folks, never use physical activity as punishment. Please do not have kids run laps because they were late. Do not, become the drill sergeant with the drop and give me 20 routine. Physical activity as punishment builds those negative attitudes around that activity. That is not what we want to do in schools. On the flip side, never withhold recess as punishment. And this is something I still see teachers do on a regular basis. You didn't turn in your homework, so you miss recess. When in fact, those are probably the kids that really need to have that break in activity. Or worse yet, okay, you're sitting on the red line or the bench during recess. So you're out of the classroom, but you just get to watch what happens because you're being punished for something. Let's try to avoid that as well. All right, so how are we doing with all of this? Greater awareness, decreased consumption of sugar-sweetened beverages, and decrease in screen time do make a difference. One last quick video. Obesity rates for preschoolers are starting to drop.
It is the first significant victory in the war on childhood obesity. A government study finds obesity among preschoolers fell to 8% over the past decade. That is a 43% drop. Dr. Holly Phillips is here. So, doctor, this is a pretty significant drop.
This is really, really impactful, Nora, and it's impactful for two reasons. First, we've been calling obesity an epidemic in our country for about 20 years, and today marks the first time we've made such a significant improvement.
And why have we made the improvement?
Well, you know, the researchers are looking at a few things. Number one, more women are breastfeeding, which also helps to control weight in babies. We're taking in fewer sugary drinks, but also there's been a huge amount of public awareness, which has improved activities for kids both in the home and in daycare. But one of the most important things about the study is that we've changed the weight in kids, which what we know about the science of obesity is we can reset what's called their weight fate, which is the likelihood that they'll be obese as adults and battle obesity throughout life.
Because don't the studies show heavy kids make heavy adults, that what weight you are at age 5 can be determinative for the rest of your life?
Right, Nora, the science behind it is really astounding. If you are obese in kindergarten, you're twice as likely to be obese in eighth grade, and 4 times as likely to be an obese adult and battle obesity for the rest of your life. So that's why these changes in the young kids really show that we're kind of turning a corner.
Yeah. But there's still an epidemic because of overweight in America.
Yeah. There absolutely is. And actually, the same study showed obesity is holding steady for adults and even going up in women over 60. But today, we're just looking at the positive.
So bottom line, you can change your kids by what you feed them early on.
Completely. Okay.
Thank you.
Doctor.
And if we can start to make those changes in our young kids, we have that potential to change families, which will affect that adult piece. All right, so there is a light at the end of the tunnel. We know what we need to do. It's making healthy food choices, being physically active. All right, so that brings me to the end of our time together this week. Thank you so much for joining me as we finished up that nutrition and physical activity component of the content standards for health education. Please remember that you have a journal entry and your second quiz due by Monday evening, 11:59 p.m. Don't be late. Next week, we will start the content area of alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs. That's chapters 11 and 12. And don't forget that next week, your second discussion board is due, as well as the second exam. So you've got some things that you can do this weekend and also prepare for next. So with all of that, here is wishing each of you health, peace, and happiness. Hope you have a great week. Remember, make some healthy food choices. Be active this week. Take care.